The Eternal Repose video series is a controversial topic subject to conjecture and debate. The opinions shared in these episodes are not the official doctrines of the Christian Church, but are my own opinions developed through research and thoughtful contemplation. What is hell? Everybody seems to have a position on this subject. Scoffers deny its existence and see hell as a means to manipulate the ignorant masses. Moderates construe the idea of hell as a symbol of psychological turmoil and despair. Yet, other more conservative thinkers see hell as a literal realm of existence chronicled in the Bible. Who is right? Who is wrong? This is the question that needs an answer. In recent years, hell has become a fashion statement. Western society is infatuated with the macabre, with death, demons, and skulls. Everywhere we look, we see the imagery of hell. Has hell become a vain and foolish fantasy used to sell products? This could be a dangerous thing to do. The doctrine of hell has an evolution, like all doctrine we believe. And the formation of hell has a history that predates Christianity by thousands of years. Dr. Alan Bernstein, author of The Formation of Hell, made the following statement. Hell is a divinely sanctioned place of eternal torment for the wicked. It is divinely sanctioned because the God, or the gods, who established it could have refrained from creating it and could at any time abolish it. Its existence depends on some divinely established purpose. He also wrote that the concept of hell arose from an array of different approaches to death, the afterlife, and justice in the Mediterranean world. Two views of hell have survived from the ancient world. The first view being a neutral concept of death that emanated from Mesopotamia in the middle of the 3rd millennium BC, and the second came from Egypt in the middle of the 2nd millennium that added a moral application of punishment or reward to the realm of the dead. Early Babylonian myths show that death was viewed in a neutral context. Good or bad was not included in the equation. The power of the netherworld was its ability to imprison the dead with no hope of return to the land of the living. The Babylonian Epic of Gilgamesh was the first chronicled evidence of the existence of the netherworld. This myth describes a great divide that separates the land of the dead from the land of the living. This great epic myth describes the great trials that Gilgamesh wrestled with when he contemplated his own mortality. We read, "Must I too, like him, lay me down not to rise again forever and ever?" The Sumerian version of the Epic of Gilgamesh adds an additional element to the myth. It is the assault by the mortal Inanna, also known as Ishtar, on the netherworld as a means of attaining power over the dead. Portions of the myth seem to indicate that the reproductive power of the earth emanates from the netherworld. Therefore, this assault disrupted the fertility of the earth. Sympathetic fertility rites were used by pagans as a means to reinforce the boundaries between the living and the dead, and to neutralize the consequences of Inanna's assault on the netherworld. 2. The Babylonians of the 3rd millennium BC, the netherworld had no moral judgment associated with death. But this would not always be the case once the netherworld reached Egypt. The realm of the dead in early Egyptian mythology was called Tuat, and this realm was flanked by a great river and fields cultivated by various gods. Tuat, to the Egyptians, was a realm that included both rewards and punishments that were dispensed by patron deities. The pyramid texts of the 5th and 6th dynasty identify the chief god as Amun-Ra, the sun god, and the text also links the pharaoh with the sun. According to this text, the pharaoh could ascend into the heavens and enjoy eternal life, but he must first take an exculpatory oath before he dies. In this oath, the pharaoh would swear that he committed no offense against his people or his gods. The pyramid text was the first to add a moral element to the myth of Tuat and the netherworld. The next major change to the Egyptian view of the afterlife came from the coffin text of the Middle Kingdom. The reward of eternal life was no longer restricted to the pharaohs only, but now was offered to all his subjects who would swear the exculpatory oath. The coffin text put a moral prerequisite on those who received this reward. At this point, the idea that life deeds would be weighed in the balance began. The Egyptian netherworld took another big leap during the New Kingdom era with the introduction of the Egyptian Book of the Dead. The exculpatory oath and the weighing of actions ran side by side in this work. Judgment of the Dead stands out very clearly. The heart of the dead is put on a balance and weighed against the feather. Should the heart fail the test, it is consumed by a crocodile-headed female demon named Emet, who was also known as the Soul Eater. What is not clear in the Book of the Dead is what happens to the soul that is consumed by the Soul Eater. the Book of the Dead alludes to post-mortem punishment, but is not clear as to the type of torment to be experienced. Other later works brought into clarity the punishment of the Egyptian netherworld, and these works are the Book of Gates and Amentuat. In the realm of Tuat, there exists 4 fire-filled pits tended by demonic keepers, overseen by the master of the lords of the pits, and these pits are used by the gods to destroy their enemies. The Book of Gates also speaks about a lake of fire known as Surser, which is surrounded by human souls condemned to live there. The Book of Amentuat also describes similar fiery scenes of torment. However horrible these torments sound, in Egyptian lore, their punishment is not eternal. The Egyptian dead who failed judgment were dismembered and quickly destroyed through burning. The netherworld, among the Greeks, also underwent a slow evolution. The first recorded instance of the netherworld, being the land of shades and ghosts, came from Homer's Odyssey, where the hero, Odysseus, journeyed to the land of Hades in order to learn his future from the dead seer Tiresias. This work presented 2 interesting insights. The first being the immortality of the soul, and the second being the netherworld, the realm of the Greek god Hades. Hades, in this myth, has 2 levels. 1 level for human souls, and the other level for superhuman rebels, sentenced to undying work and toil for resisting the divine order. The Hymn to Demeter, written around the 7th century BC, describes Hades as a granary for seed, the prison house for Persephone, and a warehouse for the dead. It is interesting to note the similarities between this hymn and the Sumerian version of the Epic of Gilgamesh, where Persephone was substituted for the mortal Inanna. Through these tales of Homer and Hesiod's Theogony, we have a clear linkage of Hades with the idea of punishment for our deeds. The Greek philosophers and poets followed the Egyptians in that the netherworld was a place of both rewards and punishments. In the 6th century BC, a secret cult arose around the poems of Orpheus, who insisted that the dead must rid themselves of the evil part of their nature by ritual and moral purification through a series of reincarnations. The devotees of this cult pronounced horrible curses and terrible suffering in the afterlife on those who rejected their concept of sacrifice. Some of the initiated into this cult believed that it was possible for the living to perform rituals that assisted the souls in the afterlife. The philosophers Plato and Adimantus, Plato's brother, rejected these notions because it removed personal accountability for the deeds done while alive. Plato wrote in his letters, "We must at all times give our unfeigned assent to the ancient and holy doctrines which warn us that our souls are immortal, that they are judged, and that they suffer the severest punishments after our separation from the body." Plato also said in the Phaedo, "If death were a release from everything, it would be a boon for the wicked." According to Greek mythology, the netherworld had two possible destinations for the departed souls. The righteous departed would travel to the Isles of the Blessed to live in happiness, while the unjust are sentenced to Tartarus, the prison of the damned. Plato did make a distinction between the unjust. He described a judgment process where the curable unjust were purged and purified, then released, while the incurable are sentenced to eternal torment in Tartarus. The Romans believed that warriors, heroes, and those who died with honor would enjoy their rest in the fields of Elysium. The second destination was the plains of Asphodel, where good people lived as shades or ghosts, while Tartarus was the third and final realm reserved for the evil. The philosopher and poet Virgil, a close confidant to Emperor Augustus, seemed to support Plato in his view of the netherworld. Virgil's underworld resembled Plato's. Both contained an area of judgment distinct between Elysium and Tartarus. There is no way to undervalue the importance Virgil had to the development of the Roman view of the netherworld. His graphic imagery and descriptions of the netherworld inspired subsequent poets and theologians such as Dante of Dante's Inferno and Clement of Alexandria, Origen, and Augustine of Hippo. All of these myths concerning the afterlife speak to a deep-seated belief in the immortality of the soul and the existence of a netherworld. From the Babylonians to the Greeks and Romans, the belief in a netherworld is a major part of their religions and myths. Even though these ancient societies developed extensive myths concerning the afterlife, these myths do not nullify the reality of hell. Maybe the ancients were more aware of the afterlife than we realize. How did the early Hebrew nation view death and the netherworld? It is generally maintained that the early Hebrews did not have a belief in life after death, but this is not totally accurate. The conquests of Canaan by the Israelites brought the Jewish nation into close proximity to the polytheistic beliefs and rituals of their defeated foes. In the book of Deuteronomy, a stern warning is given to the Israelites that any spiritist or medium that consults the dead is to be driven out of the land or killed. Why would God issue such a prohibition? Because God understood that the Jewish people were weak in their faith and would slip into polytheism along with the Canaanites. Archaeological evidence has confirmed that this corruption did occur. Artifacts in Palestine have identified sacrificial sites where offerings were made to dead family members. Cults for the dead began to form shortly after the conquest of Canaan, and the use of mediums to consult the dead was a constant source of trouble and confusion for the Israelite people. These cults were severely persecuted, and their ritual high places were constantly being burned to the ground. But these old religious pagan practices did not die out. Even though the immortality of the soul was not part of the early Hebrew liturgy, its undercurrents could still be felt in the Hebrew religious system. The most dramatic contact with the dead came from King Saul, who was facing an impending battle with the Philistines. In his fear and need for counsel, Saul secretly consulted a woman necromancer in the small town of Endor, who was to conjure the soul of Samuel the prophet. This narrative is significant for several reasons. First and foremost, this witch succeeded in calling the soul of Samuel back to the land of the living. The risen figure was clearly Samuel. The shade had his memories and it had the power to see the future. This account reaffirms the reality that life does exist after death. The second thing to note is that Samuel was seen coming up from the depths of the earth, and Saul's inquiry disturbed Samuel's rest. Where is this place that the soul of Samuel found rest? Hebrew tradition identifies this location as Shiloh, the place of the dead, also known as the grave, hell, or the pit. The third fact that we can glean from this narrative is that Shiloh is neutral in regards to morality and justice. Notice that Samuel informed Saul that shortly he and his sons would join him in Shiloh. The early concept of Shiloh was not seen as a realm of justice and punishment. It was morally neutral, seen only as the gloomy pit of the grave. It is interesting to note that the Hebrew word Shiloh is used 66 times in the Old Testament to describe the grave, hell, and the pit. Shiloh migrated into the New Testament when the translators of the Greek Septuagint exchanged the Hebrew word Shiloh for the Greek word Hades. Shiloh to the Hebrews is seen as the equivalent of Hades to the Greeks. Shiloh is regarded as an underground region filled with shadow and gloom, where disembodied souls have a conscious but dull and inactive existence. The Hebrew people initially regarded Shiloh as morally neutral, where both the righteous and the unrighteous go at death. The Hebrew people also envisioned Shiloh as a gathering place for the dead to be assembled in their tribes and families. Hence, we often see the expression in the Pentateuch, to be gathered to one's people, or to go to one's fathers. Expressions like these, found in the Pentateuch, clearly show that the idea of life after death was part of the early Hebrew liturgy, but it just wasn't a major player. Some Bible teachers view shallow as a state of unconsciousness, but this would be a mistake. The incident between the ghost of Samuel with Saul clearly reveals that the Rephaim, the inhabitants of Shiloh, maintain their memories and have some degree of communication. Some teachers have also insisted that God is not present in Shiloh, but this would be inconsistent with Scripture. If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. God is everywhere. This one point should never be forgotten. As a rule in the Old Testament, Shiloh had no moral distinction. But as we draw closer to the New Testament, the idea of rewards and punishments developed. Isaiah was the first prophet who made a distinction between the dead in the netherworld by compartmentalizing Shiloh into levels reserved for the enemies of Israel. Ezekiel came along after Isaiah and also compartmentalized Shiloh. He divided the dead between the circumcised and the uncircumcised. He also subdivided the dead between those who died by the sword and those who didn't. Ezekiel also wrote that the shame of the dead would follow them into Shiloh. In other words, our deeds do follow us, both good and bad, into the afterlife. In verse 23 of the same chapter, Ezekiel seems to divide Shiloh into different destinations. He said that the remotest part of Shiloh belonged to the enemies of Israel. The idea of an afterlife that includes both rewards and punishments was also developed by Daniel the prophet, who divided the dead between the righteous and the unrighteous. Daniel said the righteous would rise and shine as bright as the stars of heaven, while the unrighteous would suffer everlasting contempt. During the intertestamental period of the Maccabees, the Greek concept of Hades was slowly absorbed into the Hebrew concept of Shiloh. For nearly 3,000 years, the concept of life after death and the netherworld did not change much. From the Babylonian myth of Gilgamesh to the Egyptian mythology of Tuat, to the Greek myth of Hades and Tartarus, and to the Hebrews' concept of Shiloh, the vision of the netherworld did not change much. The only thing that was added to the netherworld came from the Greeks and the Hebrews, who compartmentalized hell. In all these cultures, the souls of the dead all descended to the same place in the netherworld. The name and purpose for the netherworld might be different in each culture, but the basic concept is the same. A monolithic change was coming to the universal understanding of hell, and that change would come from an itinerant preacher from the city of Nazareth. All things would change, with the life, death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The focus of Christianity would shift from punishment after death to the concept of eternal life. Jesus taught extensively on the gift of eternal life because he knew that he was the source of eternal life to all mankind. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Jesus proved his claim to eternal life by raising the widow's son in Nain from the dead. He also raised Jairus' daughter, Lazarus, and even himself from the dead. What more proof would you need? We have no idea what a shock these resurrections were to the Jewish religious people. According to the Hebrew concept of Sheol and the Greek concept of Hades, death was permanent. The soul would descend to Sheol or Hades and never get out. These miracles just shattered all the prevailing doctrines concerning the afterlife and the netherworld. There is no doubt that eternal life and resurrection is the main focus of the New Testament, but the concept of hell is still present. Jesus taught that hell was a place of fire, and it was a place that the whole body can go to. Consider this thought when we speak of the final resurrection and the last judgment. Jesus also taught that hell was a place of condemnation, and the fires of hell are eternal, with hell being a place prepared for the devil and his angels. There is one parable taught by Jesus that reveals some interesting facts concerning the afterlife. And that parable is the rich man and Lazarus the beggar, related in the Gospel of Luke. Notice that each man was immediately judged upon death and sentenced. Lazarus was allowed to enter the sweetness of Abraham's bosom, while the rich man was condemned to the fires of hell. The other fact that we see is the compartmentalizing of Sheol. The righteous dead journey to Abraham's bosom, a place of joy and peace, while the unrighteous are sentenced to hell, the burning prison house of Tartarus. Interesting to note how this parable seems to connect with the Greek and Roman concept of Hades and Elysium. The most common word for hell in the New Testament was the Greek word Gehenna, that came from the Aramaic word Gehinnom, that references a valley south of Jerusalem. This valley was used in Old Testament times by idolatrous Jews to offer their children to Moloch in sacrificial fires. During the New Testament era, the valley became a common receptacle for all the refuse of the city. Dead animals and the bodies of criminals were cast into the consuming fire that was not allowed to go out. This grotesque image became the symbol used by Jesus to describe hell. This word is used only 12 times in the New Testament. the two other Greek words used in the New Testament for hell have a distinctive Greek origin. The second most common word is Hades, and it is used 10 times. But we have one other Greek word that is used only once in the New Testament by the Apostle Peter, and that word is Tartarus. Peter used this word to describe the deepest part of hell that is reserved for the fallen angels. It is interesting to note that Tartarus is known in Greek mythology as the prison house of Hades. The Apostle John, in the book of Revelation, also describes an eternal lake that is burning with brimstone. But what is interesting is that this lake does not seem to be hell. Let's read. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death, and whoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. According to John, death and hell are thrown into the lake of fire at the last judgment. The Greek word used by John to identify hell is Hades. How much of the Greek concept of Hades do we bring forth into the New Testament? This is a hard question to ask because I don't have an answer. But consider this thought with me. I personally believe that the last judgment will occur just as John described the event. With Hades being thrown into the lake of fire, this action would destroy the entire concept of the pre-Christian netherworld. What have Christians throughout history believed about hell? Generally, our early Christian fathers showed little interest in the lurid details of hell. But there are two noted exceptions to this rule, and they are the Apocalypse of Peter from the 2nd century and the Apocalypse of Paul from the 3rd century. Each of these works are part of the apocryphal New Testament, and they narrate lurid and at times erotic descriptions of hell. Each work compartmentalized hell based on the sin and corruption of the individual soul. These two works will provide background illustrations to Dante Alighieri in his three-book Divine Comedy in the 14th century. How do we reconcile the pagan concept of the netherworld with the Christian view of hell? For thousands of years, the great thinkers of the Babylonians, the Egyptians, and the Greeks formulated a progressive understanding of the netherworld. Should we ignore all they said and wrote? Justin Martyr, an early Christian apologist from the 2nd century, did not think we should ignore the great thinkers of the past. He taught the idea that the eternal Logos, the Word of God, was active in seed form in all people. He said, whatever things were rightly said among all men are the property of us Christians. For all the writers were able to see realities darkly through the sowing of the implanted word that was in them. Our early church fathers also had varying opinions on hell. Clement of Alexandria viewed the fires of hell as a source of purification, not destruction, while Irenaeus of Lyons strongly believed in eternal punishment, but he did not develop a systematic understanding of hell. Tertullian, the Christian apologist from the late 2nd and early 3rd century, in his writings against paganism, used the eternal flame tended by the vestal virgins of Rome as an effective symbol of the eternal fires of hell. Anthonaeus, Patriarch of Alexandria in the 3rd century, seems to imply that the wicked would be annihilated at the Last Judgment, but he did not support the idea that damnation was an endless slide towards nothingness. Gregory of Nyssa, a bishop from the 4th century, leaned toward the purging of the soul after death. He also supported Origen's theory that Satan will ultimately be restored to union with God. Augustine of Hippo, a bishop from the early 5th century, defended the doctrine of eternal punishment against the followers of Origen, who viewed hell as a form of purgatory. Augustine believed in some form of purging, but he did not associate this purification with hell. As you can see, three different views of hell emerged from our early church fathers. There was not a consensus in opinion about hell and eternal judgment. The focus of the early church was on the second coming of Jesus Christ, the general resurrection, and the last judgment. Even into the 5th century, the church waited for the second coming of Jesus. Therefore, they envisioned the dead as being asleep, waiting for the resurrection. During the medieval period, there would be a shift from these doctrines to the immortality of the soul and its afterlife experience. As the second coming of Jesus Christ seemed to be remote, Christians began to focus on the doctrines of the immediate judgment of each soul. Anselm of Canterbury, from the 12th century, argued for eternal duration of punishment in hell. He argued that to sin against an eternal God demands and eternal punishment. Peter Lombard of the 12th century and Thomas Aquinas of the 13th century followed Augustine in insisting on a fiery hell with real physical torments. Martin Luther envisioned hell in terms of alienation from God that came about from the futile human effort to justify his or her own work. Luther rejected the doctrine of purgatory and stressed the importance of accepting the Word of God. John Calvin supported Luther's concept that salvation could only come from the Word of God. He also focused on damnation being separation from God and not on the physical description of hell. John Milton, a 17th century poet and author, wrote a poetic masterpiece called Paradise Lost, which pictured a humanized Satan that was in contrast to the traditional, grotesque devil of the Middle Ages. Milton included a physical description of hell that was centered around a lake of fire. He wrote, "No light, but rather darkness visible, served only to discover sights of woe, regions of sorrow, doleful shades, where peace and rest can never dwell, hope never comes, that comes to all, but torture without end." The Jesuit religious order added an interesting twist to the punishments of hell. The Jesuit hell was unbearably crowded with the damned who stood face to face in a claustrophobic dungeon and cesspool pressed together like grapes in a wine press. Nothing like taking a road trip. We all love the adventure of travel, but what if your road trip was a trip to hell? This is the case for probably the most influential literary work from the 14th century, called The Divine Comedy, written by Dante Alighieri. This author wrote a 3-volume poetic work that chronicled his journey to heaven, purgatory, and hell. Dante's Inferno followed in the steps of the Apocalypse of Peter and the Apocalypse of Paul from the 2nd and 3rd century that graphically described the physical attributes of hell. According to the poem, in the year 1300, Dante finds himself wandering in a dark and gloomy forest where, after fleeing a lion, a leopard, and a she-wolf, he encounters the Roman poet Virgil, who guides him through the realms of hell. It is important to note that Dante did not break with the accepted view of the universe in his day. He envisioned a Ptolemaic universe around which circled 9 crystalline heavenly spheres of planets and stars, with the top sphere being the premium mobile, the first mover, which keeps the universe in order. Beyond the spheres was the Empyrean, the home of God. Dante's Inferno is an inverted reverse copy of the Ptolemaic universe. He described 9 circles of hell where he compartmentalized each level of sin. When the 2 poets entered hell, they passed under a sign that read, "Abandon all hope, ye who enter here." Dante envisioned the first level of hell being limbo, the place the Romans called the Elysium Fields. The next 4 levels of hell were for the sins of passion, such as lust, gluttony, greed, and wrath. Dante and Virgil then saw the city of Dis, also known as the capital city of Satan. According to Dante, the walls of this city were made of red-hot iron. Dante believed that all the traditional fires of hell are located in this city. He also put the next 4 levels of hell in this city, He believed that these levels were reserved for heretics, the violent, and the final level, known as the pit, was reserved for all traitors. It is impossible to undervalue Dante's Divine Comedy because it became the staple and standard of thinking for the concept of hell throughout the Middle Ages into the modern world. The traditions of hell described by Dante carried through the Reformation. The first true assault on the doctrine of hell came during the Age of Enlightenment from men like David Hume, Voltaire, and Jean Rousseau, who believed that hell was used as a coercive form of manipulation. The traditional concept of hell has been in a tug of war with the rationalists since the Enlightenment. Even to this day, the banter continues. There is a fiery hell, to there is no hell. In the latter 20th century, another theory surfaced, that is the belief that we make our own hell. Oscar Wilde, a playwright of the late 19th century, made the following quote. We are each our own devil, and we make this world our hell. Has the belief in hell died out? In May of 2004, a Gallup poll survey revealed that 70% of the people surveyed believed in hell. This number is up considerably from the same survey in 1997, where only 56% of the people surveyed believed in hell. In some regards, the belief in hell is enjoying a renaissance because modern society is pondering their eternal hereafter once again. Our walk through history has revealed that three basic views of hell have traveled the centuries and can still be heard today from our church pulpits and social media. These views are: the punishment view maintains that a majority of the human race will not be saved. Each person is judged at the point of death and given either eternal life or eternal condemnation. Hell is a place of endless conscious punishment for sin, and once a person is in hell, there is no exit. Roman Catholics incorporate into this view the idea of purgatory, a place of purification for those who are destined for heaven. The punishment doctrine is the traditional view of Protestant Christianity. According to the doctrine of annihilationism, the human soul is not naturally immortal, while eternal life is a gift of God to the redeemed. The unrepentant will be punished, but this period of punishment will be temporary. At the final resurrection, the unrepentant will be destroyed and cease to exist. The biblical fire of hell is a consuming rather than a tormenting fire. The doctrine of universalism believes that eventually all people will be saved and God will restore His creation to perfect harmony. The unrepentant will be punished, but this period of punishment will be temporary. According to this doctrine, if there is a hell, it is temporary, not eternal. It functions to lead the sinner toward repentance and union with God. More extreme versions of universalism teaches that even the devil can ultimately repent and be saved. How apt is the sign over hell as envisioned by Dante? Abandon all hope, ye who enter here. Does hell exist? I firmly believe it does, and that the Bible is correct in its description of hell. But we are not the only religious people who believe in hell. For nearly 4,000 years, nearly every major civilization has formulated a concept of hell. Can all these societies be wrong? Is hell only a myth used by priests to control their people? I think not. Often, I hear statements such as, "I guess I'm just going to hell." Are you so flippant with the idea of hell that you make it a foolish jib? Just because you do not believe in hell does not mean hell does not exist. It is a dangerous thing you do when you make hell a joke. You do not know the value of eternal life until you are dead.